Bethel World Outreach Church. Reaching a city to touch the world.
Well, Pastor Keith Tower, what a name. You know, when you're 7 feet tall and you're named Keith Tower, that's something to live up to. Now, my name is Rice, and there's not a whole lot to that, you know, other than they love me in China, as we said. So, but Keith Tower pastors High Point Church. Are we seeing some stuff going on, Sister Debbie? High Point Church, Keith Tower. But Keith, Notre Dame, University of Notre Dame, correct? It's a big deal. That would have been enough. But he played in the NBA, and he'll tell about that. He was on the same team with Shaquille O'Neal, so he had to practice against Shaq. Can you imagine having to face that every day? I mean, you're talking about a trial. But he's dunked on Shaq. I could have, too, with enough help with a ladder. But Pastor Keith, his church in Orlando, they have a real unique thing because we have three Every Nation churches in Orlando. One is pastored by Pastor Tim, our own beloved Pastor Tim, who won the Super Bowl. You have Keith, who played in the NBA, and then you have Shadi Solomon, who is an Egyptian. And I couldn't introduce him. I'd have to really explain him. But the three of them are doing such a great work in the city. Keith not only pastors a great church, his wife Jennifer, his two daughters, Chloe and Carly. Did I get it right? And but he's really got a heart for missions. He goes down into Latin America. He's been going to Cuba. How many times in Cuba? 14 trips to Cuba. I came out to meet Jesus and to hear from Pastor Keith tonight. So could you welcome in a real rousing way on a Wednesday night in the midst of the rain, welcome Pastor Keith Tower. There we go. Give him some love.
The opportunity, my friend.
Come on, Baby James. I need to see Baby James Lowe. Baby James Lowe, where are you standing up? I need some stand up. There we go. Come on now. Help a brother.
Thank you, sir. Appreciate it. All right. Good evening. Man, what an honor. I am 7 feet tall. My last name is Tower. But can I tell you, I'm getting the privilege to stand where giants have stood before me. True giants. This is not your home church. What are you doing? It ought to be. This is a church from Orlando that we watch and admire from afar and do our best to emulate because God's doing incredible stuff with you. And when we think of how do we best emulate an incredible church like Bethel here in Brentwood, we try to emulate your great leaders. Pastor James and Debbie are world class. You are so fortunate. It's tough when you've got amazing leaders. Sometimes you can just think that that's just the way, you know, the churches are. They're not. Most are led by people like me, but you have someone like them. And you should thank God every day. If you ever wonder if he loves you, I want you to look at the leaders he's given you and know that he thinks really highly of you for the people he's given to help shape and form you. As Pastor Rice mentioned, I played in the NBA. I played professional basketball for 7 years. And when I say played professional basketball, when you play the same position as Shaquille O'Neal, you watch a lot of professional basketball. I didn't play much. But I did play at the most important time. When I was playing with the Orlando Magic, they had this promotion with McDonald's. They called the Mac Attack. So if the team scored 110 points and won, everyone in the arena got a free Big Mac. Now, back in those days, I mean, this was the 90s, right? You know, with smash mouth and tough defense and you're grinding out games at 80 and 90 points. If you scored 110 and won, it means you blew them out. So you were probably up by 20 or 30 points. And so that's the time where coach looks at Shaq and goes, let me get him out of here so he doesn't get hurt, right? Let me put Tower in and maybe he'll hurt somebody, right? That's kind of, so Shaq would go out and I would come in during the Mac Attack. And the way it would work was every point above 100, we're trying to get to 110, we'd score a basket, get to 102, and the announcer would come on, 8 points for the Mac Attack, and everyone would scream and yell. Now the key was, you had to stay because they would stamp your ticket on the way out, which was great for a player like me because I'd still have 20,000 people cheering me on. We'd score another basket. 6 points for the Mac Attack. I'll never forget, I checked into a game. We had 106 points. 4 points for the Mac Attack. I check into the game. There's not much time left. We've got the ball. We come down and we score very quick. We're at 108. 2 points for the Mac Attack. But there's literally like 5 or 6 seconds left. So normally what you would do is you just let the ball bounce, the clock would go down, the other team would lick their wounds and go into the locker room. But for whatever reason, they throw the ball in. And the guy starts charging up the court. And I'm thinking, man, if I run down here and he misses, you know, he's going to throw up a half-court shot. Maybe I can get a rebound and get in the stat book, you know? Like, this is a big deal for someone who doesn't play much. So I come running down, and sure enough, the guy launches a shot as the clock's winding down, and I grab the rebound. It's under a second left, about 0.4 seconds. I grab the rebound. I turn around, and they foul me, which means I am going to be walking down to the other end to take 2 free throws with 20,000 Big Macs hanging in the balance. So I start walking down the court, and it was the weirdest, like most surreal. There's just like this sort of hushed murmur that kind of starts going up, and you could just hear this. I'm walking down the court, and I'm like, I wonder what they're whispering. And you could just hear this strange murmur of, who is that? Right? And I get to about half court, and I'm here. Is that Thompson, Toner, Tower? I get to about the top of the key, and all of a sudden, everyone's going, it's Tower. Who's Tower? I don't know, but that's Tower. I start to step up to the free throw line, and now 20,000 people are chanting my name. Tower, 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 Tower. So the ref hands me the ball, and goes deadly silent. Now, you need to know this about me. I'm clutch. Just want you to know that. All right. I don't rattle. 1 point for the Mac Attack. The place is going nuts. I mean, they're standing, screaming, Tower, Tower. One lady yells, Tower, will you marry me? I'm like, let me help you. Young people, raise your standards. I mean, my gosh, not even Chick-fil-A, right? So Tower, will you miss? Screaming, yelling. I have 20,000 brand new fans. I'm the most popular guy in Orlando with one more shot. Tower, Tower. They hand me the ball. Now you need to know this about me. I've played in the NBA playoffs. I've played in March Madness. I've played in a state championship. And I have never been more nervous for an athletic moment than these 2 meaningless free throws when we're up by 30. But I'm clutch. Just want you to know that. I missed, and I lost 20,000 friends in a moment. I went from the most popular guy in the entire city in an instant to the biggest villain in the arena. She no longer wanted to marry me. She kind of wanted to kill me. It's crazy what happens. My friends, I was asked to speak to you about mental health tonight. And can I tell you, when things are going on in our emotions, it can really impact our behavior. Because I'm clutch. But it's been said that pressure makes a coward of all of us. And what I have done thousands and tens of thousands of time, and just earlier beat your teenagers upstairs, I'm just saying. Even though it was a moment that should have been meaningless, when your emotions start to feel stress, how it can actually change the way you behave. You know that's true whether you've played sports or not. This past week, Kobe Bryant died in a helicopter crash. I played against Kobe. And I watched people who have never even been in the same state as Kobe, unable to get up and go to work the next day. to physically do what they've done time and time again, to not even be able to formulate words, which they've been doing since they were saying gaga and goo-goo, because their feelings were in a very difficult spot. You know, if you've ever struggled with depression, that sense of heaviness, how difficult it can be sometimes to just get out of bed. What's normally simple, what's normally routine, what's normally, man, I got this because I'm clutch, can become exceptionally difficult when our emotions are not in a great spot. We're going to read a passage of Scripture today. In Philippians chapter 4, you've probably heard it, especially if you've ever struggled with mental emotional health. I'm sure somebody with good intentions has prayed it for you. Philippians chapter 4, we're going to read verse 4 through 9 and talk about it. Philippians chapter 4, starting in verse 4, rejoice in the Lord always. Again, I will say rejoice. Let your gentleness be known to all men. The Lord is at hand. Be anxious for nothing, but in everything, by prayer and supplication with thanksgiving, let your requests be made known to God. And the peace of God, which surpasses all understanding, will guard your hearts and minds through Christ Jesus. Finally, brethren, that's an awesome word, whatever things are true, whatever things are noble, whatever things are just, whatever things are pure, whatever things are lovely, whatever things are of good report, if there is any virtue or if anything is praiseworthy, meditate on these things. The things that you have learned and received and heard and saw in me, these do, and the God of peace will be with you. This is kind of the big dog verse of dealing with anxiety. It is simultaneously one of the most frustrating verses and one of the most peace-giving verses. And whether or not it's frustrating or whether it gives you a sense of peace has everything to do if you know how to rightly apply it. Because Jesus talked about that you and I should be hearers and doers of the word. Right, the wise man who's the one who hears my words and puts them into practice. It's one thing to hear a word and not know how to put it into practice, especially when it's speaking to something like how you feel. A proper application of this scripture, I have a master's degree in counseling from Indiana University. I've been in private practice along with pastoring. I've been in private mental health counseling practice for 19 years. And probably, from an individual perspective, about 75% of the people that have walked into my office can be completely set free with a proper application of this verse, regardless of what you're coming in for. Because most of what people are coming in for is they don't feel right. Something's not right. My mood's too low, my mood's too high, mostly in our mood and our emotions. And if we can properly apply this, 75 at least, percent of what you and I struggle with on an individual basis, we no longer have to. And the key to understanding this verse is understanding human nature. You and I are made in the image of God, the Bible says. We're made in the image of God. Well, what does that mean? That God's 7 feet tall, balding, and dashingly handsome? I mean, maybe he's God. Why wouldn't you, right? I mean, he's got his choice. It's a good one. But it doesn't mean that he looks like us. It means that we're made in his essence. He's Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, the mystery of the Trinity, three separate, distinct, unique personalities, none of which is fully God, but all of which is fully God, but inseparable, fully united, yet separate and distinct and unique, three in one at the mystery of the Trinity. Good luck explaining that. But you're made in his image. Your personality, it bears the image of God. You're three in one. Psychology tells us, which, by the way, if you're going, no, he's talking about psychology. Psychology simply means the study of the soul. So that we're in a good place with that in church, right? Okay, good. All right. Your personality is a fluid, constant interplay between three things. Much like Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, your behaviors, your thoughts, and your feelings. Behaviors, thoughts, and feelings, also known as your actions, your mind, and your emotions. Constant, fluid interplay. No one of those is who you are, but it's all of them in a constant reaction and interaction with life situations. Okay, y'all tracking with me? Bear with me here because we're going to unpack this word. But if we don't understand this, we won't understand this. Now, two of those three, our behaviors, our thoughts, and our emotions, we have the ability to directly control, and one we don't. You have the ability to directly control your actions, right? You can choose to stand up right now. You can choose to sit down right now. You can choose to chill. You can choose to take pictures of me, right? You can do actions. And because we don't want to just base it experientially, the Bible tells us that one of the fruits of the Holy Spirit is self-control, the capacity to control oneself, which means I can actually choose to do things and choose not to do things. That's how I'm made. I also have the ability to control what I think. You do. That is directly under your control. Let's do a practice example. Ready? Everybody, form the mental image. Think of an apple. All right, some of you formed that right, you know, that nice red, beautiful thing. Some of you went, you know, back to the Garden of Eden, and, you know, some of you thought of your favorite computer, right? We all formed some mental image of an apple, the red, the yellow, the computer. You have the ability to form mental images, and we know, biblically, that we have the ability to think because Scripture tells us to take every, thought captive and do something with it. Make it obedient to the will of Christ. So when it wants to run over here, I can go, whoa, 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 stop thinking that. Is what I'm thinking true? I don't know. Let me take this thought. Let me lay this thought over the word of God. Huh, that's wrong. That's different than what, I'm gonna discard that and I'm gonna choose to believe this. You can think however you want. Now, the one of these three that you don't control directly is your emotions, your feelings. They are in fact a response to your behaviors and your thoughts. Their response. You don't directly control how you feel. Come on, husbands and wives, you ever stop feeling that way? You ever have that argument? That works. I remember sitting in a depression group. I had a men's depression group, and we're sitting around a table, and I just kind of was no longer pastoral. You know, you sometimes hit these moments where you're like, okay, I'm done, get over it, you know? Not super counselor-y. And I looked at this one guy, and I go, just stop feeling that way. He took his shoe off and threw it at me. It's the most physical activity he had in about 3 months. And he's like, how dare you tell me to not feel this way? Our feelings are a response to either our behaviors or our thoughts. Don't believe me? Okay. Imagine you're doing a behavior. You're in your garage working at a workshop, building some fantastic thing, and you swing and you miss your board with your hammer, and you hit your thumb. Well, just don't feel that. You have no choice but feel that, because the feeling of pain is a response to a behavior, and there are nerve endings firing up to your brain going, ah! Now, what I do in response to that feeling, I do have control over, because I'm gonna behave in response to that feeling. So I can let fly with some words we don't say in church. I can kick my dog, or I can just suck it up. There are actions I can do in response to my feelings, but my feeling, I have no choice. It happens in response to my action. Same with your same with your thoughts. Your feelings are a response to your thoughts. Here, ready? Let's practice. At the count of three, I want you to feel incredibly happy. All right, are you ready? One, two, three. Feel happy. Okay, here's what you did. You thought of a happy occasion. There is no thermostat that moves your emotions. Ready? Get sad. We're gonna get sad at the count of three. Ready? One, no, we're not gonna do that. But here's what happens, is you think a sad thought. You think a happy thought, and your emotions will follow because they're a response. By the way, because you can't control your emotions, that's why you should never live a life led by them. That's why follow your heart is idiotic. Because you now have no control over your life. You have no say of where you end up. That's foolish. That's why the Bible tells you how, talks about this thing called lordship, your behaviors. Talks about renewing your mind and being transformed by how you think. Living by your emotions is gonna get you in, let's not do that. Now, here's the thing about your personality, right? Much like Father, Son, and Holy Spirit are three distinct but fully one, so is your personality. the way you think, the way you act, and the way you feel in response to life situations wants to stay integrated. Which means when I'm happy feeling in my emotions, I'm probably simultaneously thinking happy thoughts. Oh, my wife's flying into town tomorrow. It's going to be awesome. We're going to be driving down to Birmingham tomorrow night to watch my daughter in a play. I'm excited about that. And guess where else it starts to show? In my behaviors, because that's an integrated personality. I'm thinking a happy thought. My emotions are happy. And it shows, right? You know what's weird? Is when someone's expressed emotion and behaviors don't line up. It's like the Joker, right? Y'all saw the Joker? You know what's the most unnerving part of that movie is he's laughing while in incredible pain, and you're just going, because what you're seeing is emotions over here and behavior over here and the disintegration of the personality. It's called a personality disorder. When my actions and my thoughts and my emotions don't line up. Now, sometimes life situations force that on us, right? Let's suppose you generally think like somebody who loves having camaraderie. You love how you work because you get along with people and, you know, it's awesome. You got this perfect job, so you like people. You have this perfect job where you work on teams and afterwards you all go out to dinner and then your kids play together on Saturday, and what you do and what you like and what you, you know, think about work perfectly, so you're super happy and satisfied at work, right? Now all of a sudden you're so satisfied at work that that satisfaction is now starting to show itself in your performance, and you're doing great, and you get a promotion. Well, this is great! And your boss comes in and goes, you've been promoted, you're now the boss of your division. By the way, we're downsizing tomorrow as your first job. I need you to fire half of your team. Okay. I'm now being asked to do a behavior that disagrees with how I think it's going to cause me a problem in my emotions. So all of a sudden, I'm going to start to stress. And then that stress is going to start to show itself in me physically because I'm not going to sleep that night. Because I'm thinking about this terrible situation coming up and I've pulled my personality apart. So just like Father, Son, and Holy Spirit are like this, your personality, your mind, your thoughts, your behaviors, and your emotions want to stay integrated. Now, sometimes life situations can pull our emotions into a stressful place, can pull our emotions into a depressed place. We're going to be talking about anxiety tonight, primarily because that's what the scripture uses, but you can apply this to whatever type of mood issue we're having, right? But let's just say I'm down here, and I'm feeling, for the sake of this discussion, I'm feeling depressed, right? The way we know depressed people are depressed is because eventually, if I'm feeling this way, my personality doesn't want to stay like this very long, which means my behaviors are going to start to look, right, like somebody whose mood has gone dark. And all of a sudden, I'm going to start to withdraw from people because my mood has gone dark, so my behaviors are going to follow, because worse than us all being in a hole is being separated from my personality. Y'all track them? Is this making sense? All right. Just follow me all the way through this. This is going to help you. So I start to feel dark. My behaviors go dark. I draw the shades. I stay in bed. My mood goes down. My energy goes down. My appetite goes down. My friendships go down. And my thoughts start to go dark. Well, how do I treat that? Well, just don't feel like that. My feelings are a response. So if I want to get my mood out of a dark place, what I have to do is change what I can control, which is either my thinking or my behavior. So we're going to start to talk about the way we think. We're going to start to renew our mind in the Bible, and we're going to start to see who God says I am, and I'm going to start to challenge. That was a great catch. That's like a professional athlete level of catch. Anyway, I'm going to start to challenge the faulty thinking that feels good down here with truth. And if I can do that long enough and consistently, my personality does not want to stay like this, and my mood is going to move. Or my thinking's going back. Now, in the case of depression, it's tough to consistently move your thinking when you feel bad, but what I can do is get you up and make you physically move. One of the ways we treat depression is we're going to go outside in the sunlight and walk for 5 minutes. And there's something in moving the behavior. We're going to pull your behavior. And if I can do that consistently, and you're going to be out there like a vampire in light going, no, I want to go back to my cave. And if you can stay there long enough, we can get enough movement, your mood will shift because your personality wants to stay integrated. Makes sense. Great. That understanding of personality and how feelings, anxiety or depression or any other mood struggle that we might have is moved by virtue of how I think and what I do. Now I need to bring that lens to what Paul's talking about here, and it won't be a frustrating verse anymore. Ready?
Yes.
Starts off, rejoice in the Lord always. Again, I will say rejoice. Rejoice here. It's not a feeling, it's an action. It's a behavior. Live in such a way as if you're leaning into God. Live in such a way as if you're thankful for who He is. Live with a God top of mindedness. Live with an active awareness of who He is. Live in such a way that He's real, He's true, and He's good to you. Let things come out of your mouth. Let actions take place such that God is good, as demonstrated in your actions, even if you don't feel like it. It matters how you worship in here on a Wednesday and Sunday. This matters. Because there is something in the choice of action and behavior to rejoice. There's something about letting a beautiful sound come out of your mouth. Sorry, I feel a little animated. There's something about the action of rejoice that is good for my mood. Because as I do a rejoicing behavior, my mood and thoughts cannot stay where they are because my personality wants to stay integrated. So either they're going to move or I'm just going to not worship. But you get to control how you act, even if you can't control how you feel. It's independent of how you feel. It's a choice to act. It's a choice to behave. It's a choice to live a certain way. And when you don't feel like living that certain way, then live by faith.
Yes.
Act by faith. 2 Corinthians 5:7, you've probably heard it a time or 10, for we walk by faith, not by sight. I don't live by what my heart feels. I live by what's right. So even if I don't feel it, I do it anyway. And oftentimes, doesn't that make me a hypocrite? No. Makes you a God-fearing, overcoming, victorious, what the Bible calls you to be. Because by choice, I'm doing something and my feelings will eventually meet me there. Like it's already done, Pastor James. I heard that somewhere. So we walk by faith and not by sight. And then the passage goes on in verse 5. Let your gentleness be known to all men. The Lord is at hand. Look at this proactive step. This passage is specifically about anxiety, and look what it says. Let your gentleness be known to all men. The Lord is at hand. When I'm anxious, gentleness is kind of the opposite of what I would naturally do. Man, when I'm stressed, and you come and add more stuff to me, I'm gonna lash out. And what this passage is saying is, if you will make a choice to not live by what you feel, but to be a person of gentleness, contrary to what you're feeling, here's what it says. The Lord is near at hand. Which means that I'm not being a hypocrite by choosing to act in a way that's different than how I feel. What I'm doing is having God next to me and empowering my behaviors to act like a Christian.
Yes.
And be gentle. I have a friend who was on the SEAL team with the American sniper, Chris Kyle. I've had a lot of conversations with him, and one of the things he always said, one of the sayings among Navy SEALs is, when the going gets tough, the tough relax. When the going gets tough, the tough relax. In other words, most people, when the going gets tough, act a certain way, and Navy SEALs just train themselves to act in the opposite way that they want to act. When your anxiety goes up, there's stuff you want to do naturally that is not gentle. But I have the ability to control my actions, so I'm going to act in a manner that's gentle. And the Spirit of God is right there with me. The Lord is near, helping me, empowering me to do it. It's not phony. It's just the right way to act, empowered by God. Because actually, when in Scripture were we let off the hook to not be gentle? It's never qualified. You're supposed to act that way anyway. All right. And I love what it says. Let your gentleness be known to all men. Which means that no matter how I feel, I'm going to act gentlemanly always to all people and consistently. I will consistently act a certain way. I will consistently, across situations, behave in a certain way. And if you understand personality, that consistent behavior impacts my mood. Then the passage says, and this is where it gets frustrating, because we like to pull this little, you know, take two scriptures and call me in the morning, pull this out of context and slap it on stuff, and it doesn't help. Verse 6, be anxious for nothing. But in everything, by prayer and supplication, with thanksgiving, let your requests be made known to God. And the peace of God, which surpasses all understanding, will guard your hearts and minds through Christ Jesus. Look at this in verse 6. Be anxious for nothing. You know what causes me stress? Is when God commands me to not be stressed. Right? Because when you're anxious, and then you get a verse that you feel like commands you to not be anxious. Now not only are you anxious, God's disappointed in you being anxious, which only makes you more anxious. So it's a good thing that this actually isn't a command to feel a certain way. It's not what it is. It's not commanding you to not be anxious, so let yourself off the hook. It's telling you there's a possibility to not be anxious. There is a state in which you can live that does not include anxiety. That's what that passage means. It doesn't say be anxious for nothing, because that's the worst. Oh my gosh. When someone comes in and goes, man, I'm really anxious. And you go, well, here, the Bible says don't be. Thanks. That's not what it says. The Bible says that there's a possibility, a likelihood, a probability. There is a way in which you can live that you're not consumed with anxiety. And we know that because it goes on. It says, be anxious for nothing, but, oh gosh, greatest word in the Bible. He's about to tell us how to live free of anxiety. And he says, in everything, by prayer and supplication, make your requests known to God. Now, most people misuse this one too. To be anxious for nothing, but in everything, just pray more. And you know what you tend to do? Is you pray more about being anxious. And guess what happens? Oh God, I'm so anxious. God, I'm so stressed. God, take this anxiety away. God, why am I still stressed? God, not only am I stressed, my hands are sweating, my stomach's in a knot. Oh God, now I'm worse. This passage actually does not tell you to even pray about your anxiety. It says to pray about everything else. It says, don't be anxious, but bring everything. So those situations about which I'm anxious. Okay, see what's happening here. Don't miss this. I'm anxious. So my stomach's in knots. I'm getting ulcers. I'm having physical behaviors. I'm getting locked up at work. Man, my mind is racing. I can't sleep. I'm stuck down here. And this passage isn't saying change how you feel. It's saying change how you behave and how you think. Pray About what? Well, I got to think about those things that are causing me anxiety. I have two kids at college that are out of state. The closest one is a 9-hour drive from me. God, I pray in the name of your son, Jesus, that you would be with Chloe even right now. Father, if she's making decisions on how she wants to live, if she's making decisions on how she wants to walk with you, God, you know I'm stressed about it, but I'm not going to worry about my stress. I'm going to worry about her, and I'm going to give her to you, and I'm going to invite you into her situation. Here's a strange thing that happens when I take that action, which is by faith, and I trust God with my thoughts. My anxiety starts to go places. Like away. So I do something. I think something. And as I pray about those situations, actively, aggressively, assertively, I pray and I make petition and I talk to God about those and I think through what it is that I'm, you know, feel like I need to bring God in mode, I need God's intervention in, it changes my mood. And watch this. This is the best part. Verse 7, and the peace of God, which surpasses all understanding, will guard your heart and minds through Christ Jesus. The peace of God will guard your heart. You know what the heart is? It's the center of your feelings, right? So the peace of God, and the word there, guard, means to stand sentry, right? You ever been to like the London and the palaces and the guards just stand out back, none shall pass, right? You're not getting past them to bring in and do harm. Right? They're keeping certain things out while simultaneously guards keep valuable things in. They keep dangers and threats out and valuable things in. The peace of God will stand and guard your heart. Now, how does that happen? I have no idea because this passage actually says it surpasses my understanding. So I don't care. It's beyond my understanding. Here's what it says. I no longer have to worry about my worry. That's God's job. Come on, somebody. That is, God is now going, I want you to pray. I want you to think, I got this. Well, how are you going to get it, God? Don't worry about it. I'm God. Yes. Yes. The peace of God itself will stand guard and sentry over my heart, keeping out of it all those things that want to put terror in there and locking in his peace so it can't get out. I like that. Yeah. All right. It's no longer your job to guard your emotions. It's your job to do God stuff and think God things. It's God's job to guard your emotions. That's why he doesn't command you to do anything with your emotions. He commands you on how to behave and he commands you on how to think because he's got your emotions. Anyway, you might be thinking, well, that's easy for Paul to say. He doesn't know how stressful life is trying to pay a mortgage in Brentwood. That's easy for Paul to say, guard your, you know, just pray about it. He's never tried to get, you know, his kid into the exact right kindergarten. It's easy for Paul to say. I mean, he's never had to set up the perfect Instagram shot. And you're right. But Paul is writing these instructions from prison to a church that he planted in the middle of a riot he started. And once that riot started, he and his church plant team got arrested, gotten beaten, and got put in the lowest part of the dungeon. And sometimes we don't really know what that means, but here's what it means at the risk of being gross. They didn't have indoor plumbing, so when anybody like above you took care of business, it flows down to your spot. And it's down in that spot. You might be familiar with the story in Acts chapter 16 where it says that Paul and his church plant team, Silas, what did they do? They rejoiced. Oh, wow. They're in a little bit of a stressful spot, and they made an active choice to center their world around Christ and do something. And I can't help but wonder if not in that moment when they were stressed on whether they were going to die at the hands of the mob or die at the hands of the filth at their feet, I wonder if somewhere in that stressful moment the peace of God came and helped them with their emotions as they made a choice to rejoice. I kind of wonder. So when he's writing back to them, he's going, don't forget your roots, man. I know life's tough. I know there's things that get you down. But don't forget. Just rejoice. Your feelings are just a response, man. Don't live by those. Just do what's right. Think about what's true. And rejoice. That's what I did. Passage goes on. In verse 8, it says, and finally, brothers, whatever things are true, whatever things are noble, whatever things are just, whatever things are pure, whatever things are lovely, whatever things are of good report, if there is any virtue, if there is anything praiseworthy, meditate. Do something with your mind. Think deeply. Meditate on those things. Let me ask you a question. How many of you guys get anxious about good reports? Good reports. How many of you get anxious around lovely things? No. So Paul's saying things that are lovely, things that are pure. Here's what I want you to do. Set your mind on those. What is of good report? Like, I get stressed about a bad report card. But man, when I get a good one, I'm coming in and going, hey, Mom, check that one out. Right? Like, I'm pleased because I know the report. So Paul's saying there are things you should think about. Move your mind to those. What is pure? What is lovely? What is worthy of praise? What I am going to do when I don't feel like thinking about those is think about them anyway, because I actually have the ability to control what I think about. And if you do, God will guard your emotions. And he'll do what he does with the personality he created. He'll integrate it back over to a happier place. Then he goes on and says, these things which you've learned and received and heard and saw in me, these, help me out, somebody, do. Behave. Act. Change your actions. What you've seen Paul do, what you've seen Pastor James do, what you've seen Pastor JT do, what you've seen Pastor Rice do. If you don't know what actions to do, just follow them, as Paul once said, follow me as I follow Christ. Just do that. Over and over and over, because the first time your emotions might pull your behavior back, just do it again. And then when your emotions pull you back, say, help me not get pulled back. And eventually, your anxiety, your depression, your obsession will move. Yes. Let me pray for you. God, I thank you for the peace of God that guards our hearts. And I thank you for the God of peace who you said would be with us. It's kind of supernatural, Lord, to not act on what we feel. But I thank you that you tell us in this passage that you're close, that you're with us. And if you're close and you're with us and you're for us, buddy, we can do it. Empower your people here to live well. Empower your people here to think well. And we trust you to make sure we feel well. In Jesus' name, amen.
Bethel World Outreach Church, reaching a city to touch the world.